Okay, hi and welcome to video notes 9.4 on multiplying special cases. So we're still under multiplication, but this is special cases. So there's two that we're going to deal with today. I'm not going to give you their names because I want to leave it a little bit of a mystery. You'll notice right now that our notes are currently blank, and that's on purpose. What I want you to do is go ahead and multiply out these binomials, right? Meaning two terms, one term, two terms, and then there's two of them and you're multiplying them. And I want you to see what the pattern is. So multiply those out and then look between what you multiply out back to the original and see if you can find a pattern. I'm going to have you pause the video after you multiply those out, write what you see here, and then I'll see you back in a couple of seconds. Okay, so welcome back. This is what you should have had, something similar to this. Maybe you did the box with the box there, the multiplication. Maybe you did a distributive property. But either way, let's talk about what you found. Hopefully you noticed that there was something going on in the middle terms here. Notice I've highlighted it for you. And that's not for like terms. It's for the fact that it seems to repeat itself in each case that we did. Every scenario, the middle terms, or what we'd like to refer to as the linear term down here at the bottom, if you follow me here, is being repeated. Or another way to say that is whatever that middle term was in these multiplications of these binomials, it was being doubled. Well, you're like, well, there's two of them. That kind of makes sense. But let's just take one more look at this. If this is x plus 8 times x plus 8, if we had 2 times 2, could we find another way to write that instead of not writing what the result is, being the product being 4? But couldn't we write it as it's squared or x times x? Couldn't that be x squared? So couldn't we say x plus 8 squared? Or couldn't we say 2m minus 3 squared? Yes, all of these then also have something in common is that it's the binomial times itself, or binomial squared. And you'll find that that's what we're going to talk about today, that there's a pattern that comes from that, one of which we just saw, meaning that the middle term, because it ends up multiplying by itself, becomes the same. So we can double it. That's a nice little pattern. But also look at what happens to the first and last term. It's easier to see, I guess, when it's squared. So what happened to the x? It became squared. What happened to the 2m? It became squared, right? 2 squared is 4. M squared is m squared. Yeah, look at this one. N became n squared. 2x became 4x squared. So the first term seems to be being squared. What about that last term? So let's take a look at that. Well, 8, or I'm sorry, easier to see here. So there's 8, 8 squared. Negative 3, negative 3 squared. Hey, 7, or negative 7, negative 7 squared is positive 49. Again, the last term also, even in this last pair here, is being squared. So the two things that you should have seen from this is that the first and last terms are being squared when it's in this form, right? When it's a square of a binomial. And the middle term is being doubled. It's super handy. Is it hard to multiply these out? Absolutely not. But is it far easier to remember this pattern? Sure is. And it's also very helpful later, especially when we get to some of our factoring. It can be useful there as well. So here's the basic rule. Now notice, real quick before we get to the basic rule, if this binomial squared had a negative for its second term, sorry, didn't quite color in the way I wanted, right? Look at what happened to the middle term. It was negative. Again, repeat that here. I'll draw it out for us. So n minus 7 squared. That second term was negative. Our middle term is also negative. So basically, if there's a negative in our binomial squared, the middle term was doubled and negative. If it was positive, it was just doubled and positive. So that's the two rules we get. If we have a binomial squared and it's positive, the middle term is doubled. Again, this is a better way to represent that because it's really a times b is what's happening there. Not the middle term. So we're going to look at multiplying the two monomials, and if it's positive, it stays positive and doubles. If it's negative, it becomes negative and doubles. And then the first term becomes squared, and the last term becomes squared. So that's pretty easy to remember. Multiply these two, right? And then square the first and last. That's a pretty easy pattern to remember. So here another is another example of that. Square the first term, multiply the two together, so 4 times x is 4x, double it, that's 8x, and then square the last term. So let's repeat that with a negative scenario of that. First term squared, multiply the two together, negative 3, double it, negative 6x, and then square the last term, which will become positive n9. That's quicker and easier, especially, well, with these easy ones where there's not a lot of stuff inside our binomial, but if you start adding squares and cubes and getting a little bit bigger, it's really handy to know that rule. All right, so one more quick example. Here's another one. This one's a little bit messier, so if you were to distribute this, might be a little bit more to keep track of, but we've got our handy perfect square trinomial, perfect square binomial. Sorry about that. So we've got our perfect square binomial pattern here. So it says we take the first term, square it. So that's going to be 16m squared. Multiply these two together. So 4m times 2 is 8m. Double that. So 16m. It's positive. So that value will be positive. And then square our last term, which is 4. Really easy to do. I'm not going to do this one here, as you can see, but I do want to talk about the first one because we saw this in the last section of video notes. This time we have a square that's filled in by another square, and really all we're looking to find is this shaded region again. So it's the same scenario as we saw in the last section of video, and if you need to go back and watch it, that's perfectly fine. So we're trying to find this area here. So what are we going to do? Well, we're going to take the area of the large square, or of the whole thing, I called it all this time, and we're going to subtract off the inner patio so we can find out how much area that walkway takes. So being a square, that means the sides are the same in measure. So we're going to be working with a binomial squared. So the area of the all is x plus 6 times x plus 6, or x plus 6 squared. The area inside, you can see, is denoted by x and x, so that'll just be x times x, or x squared. And then once we've got both of the areas, just like we did before, we're going to go ahead and subtract them. Don't forget, we used our pattern here. First term squared, middle terms multiplied, or two terms multiplied together and doubled, and our last term doubled. That's how we multiplied that out, by the way. And then we subtracted them, resulting in, I think that's the end right there, resulting in this. And this just changes the width of it, and you can see the results there. Go ahead and pause if you want to take a little bit closer of a look, but I think we've covered that pretty well. Okay, here we are. I flipped over to the second side of the notes, and look again, I have not filled the notes in. Same idea as the first one. I want you to multiply these out, these two binomials, and for all these examples here, and then again, I want you to see if you can find a pattern for them after you multiply them out. Okay, notice, they're hopefully you're paying attention. They're slightly different from the first page, so don't let that distract you. All right, we'll see you back here in a couple of seconds. Okay, here we are. We found ourselves back. This should be something similar to what you've done in your multiplications. The first thing I kind of want to point out is notice where we talked about before that the binomials could be squared, but in this one, so let me give you an example of one, 2x plus 4 times the binomial of 2x plus 4. They're identical. 2s, pluses, 4s, and x's as well. But look at in this binomial set. In this one, we do have x cubed, and we have 8 and 8. But the difference in this one is that there's a positive and negative, and that's true in all of these cases. If that's the scenario, it's really like saying 2 times negative 2 over here. We can't say that is negative 2 squared or positive 2 squared. It's not the same. So you have to mind that part. So you really do need to pay attention. These are called differences of squares, okay? Meaning that they're squared, but difference indicating that there's a negative. So in this scenario, you should have still found a pattern in all of these multiplications. Again, that should be highlighted by looking at the middle terms. Notice that all of the middle terms, while the same this time, then one negative that's involved this time, we're not in the first one, is making one of these terms a negative and one positive, which means that these two terms are turning to zero. And that will occur every time you have basically the same binomial, but one's positive and one's negative in the middle. They'll always drop to zero. That's one part of the pattern. You should have also seen from that point then that the first terms were being squared as well, just like in the first section. This one's even reversed. It still squares the same. Good to see. So all of the first terms are squaring, and really all of the last terms are squaring, but there's something unique to the last term squaring. On the last term, let me grab a quick highlighter here. On the last term, you'll notice that all of them end as a negative. So, because you're taking negative 4 this time and multiplying by 4, or negative m squared and multiplying by m squared, so they all result in a negative. So the first term is squared, Okay, but the last term is squared and negative. So let's jump down here to our rules real quick. So let's take a look. General rule then, if you have a binomial that's the same but has a negative in it, we call that difference of squares, okay? Because it's squared, but it's a difference. And what we're going to find is the middle term is going to drop to zero. Notice there's no middle term, no AB term in the middle, right? Where we would multiply an A and a B in that product. And the last term, while being squared, becomes a negative. So a quick example of that, x times x, or in this scenario, this binomials, you'll take x, you'll square it, you'll take negative 2 and square it and make it negative at the end. This is actually the one that you should probably prefer out of the two because it drops out a term. There's a missing piece, and that makes it easier when there's one less thing that we have to worry about. So here's some examples you can take a peek at. I didn't give you a chance to do any of these, but I'm not going to do any of these with you, but if you look really quickly, there's v squared, right? Of this, again, positive and negative, and then the last term squared and negative. So these are worth just looking at. You're going to do them quickly. Here's a little summary of everything we've done today. So we dealt with a square of a binomial. Again, looking at those, first term squared, last term squared. If it's positive in the middle, we multiply the two terms and make it positive. If it's negative in the middle, we multiply the two terms and make it doubled in the middle as well. All right, that one you should remember. This one's your favorite, though. Because you take the first term, you square it, you take the last term, you square it, the middle terms turn to zero, and you drop a negative down in the middle. Really easy to remember. But the key is, you got to recognize, same binomial, opposite signs. Same binomial, opposite signs. So if you can remember that and you can see it, it makes your life far easier when you go ahead to multiply this out. All right, good job today. We'll see you in class.